Hello, I'm glad to be part of this information session on mineral resources. I'm going to start by addressing critical minerals in the context of global mineral resources. So I will take a very general view to set the stage for the more detailed information that the subsequent speakers will provide. So if we think about mineral resources, the first question that we could ask is, why are minerals important? For some of you, this will be old news, but for others, they tend not to think a lot about the mineral resources that are necessary for all of the equipment that makes modern life so wonderful. This slide is an example of one of those technologies. The cell phone that everybody has in their pocket has changed dramatically over the last 20, 25 years. On the left, it shows the old cell phones that you more or less had to lug around in your briefcase. And they use roughly 30 elements to make them function. And a modern cell phone, not picking on any particular manufacturer, uses almost the entire periodic table, in excess of 75 elements. And what's important about this is that even though the total amount of mineral resources in a modern phone is small, each and every one of those elements is critical for the functionality of that device. This would be true whether we're talking about a phone, a television set, or a jet fighter. So this is one way of thinking about the importance of mineral resources. Another way of thinking about this is in terms of the total amount of resources that are used by modern civilization. This is a rather startling infographic illustrating that China in the last 3 years has used more cement than the United States did in the previous 100 years. This is a rather amazing fact when you think about building the entire U.S. interstate freeway system, the huge growth of cities like Los Angeles, Houston, Miami that were a fraction of their size a century ago. And in 3 years, China has used more cement than the United States did in 100 years. So we have not only the importance of individual elements, but we have the total amount of material being used growing very, very quickly. One of the reasons for this, and the underlying driver, is the change in world population. And this graph shows for the previous century that world population has increased more than four times over that time period, from less than 2 billion people on Earth to about 7 billion at present and projected to get to about 9 billion by 2050. So this is a huge increase in the number of people who are consuming. And then we've also got an increase in per capita consumption. What that means is that each individual is consuming more material, largely due to rising standards of living and the reduction of poverty on a worldwide scale. And when you put these things together, the increase in per capita and the increase in world population, you've got more than 25 times increase in production of mineral resources. This particular graph is for copper, but I could do it for almost any element in the periodic table. So these are fundamental drivers for the need for mineral resources. And that leads us to several fundamental facts that the world needs to wrestle with. So first, as world population and standards of living increase, we need new resources. And this word new is important. Recycling, even if it was 100% efficient, cannot supply the entire need because we have more people who are consuming more stuff, and a lot of the mineral resources are sequestered for periods of years, to decades, to centuries, in buildings, in cars, so they're not available for recycling, no matter how efficient it is. This is not an argument against recycling. We should do as much and as intensely as we can, but the underlying point is that recycling by itself cannot supply the need of society for new mineral resources. Similarly, more efficient or innovative manufacturing and technology can help, but they also cannot supply the entire need because the need itself is growing. So we need to look at a complete life cycle analysis that includes the upstream, exploration, discovery, and production, as well as the downstream, manufacturing, recycling, disposal, all of these together in the life cycle of mineral resources. This will be explored in more detail later, but the world is interconnected for all these mineral resources. This is a graph that's very widely used around the world and has been shown on the floor of the U.S. Congress several times. And it illustrates that the United States is dependent on many, many countries for many, many different mineral resources. The top bars, 100% blue all the way to the right, are things that we are 100% dependent upon other countries for our modern manufacturing and lifestyle. Another way of looking at this same graph is to look at it spatially. And so this shows the same thing. It illustrates what countries we import many of our mineral resources from, and it's color-coded, with the darkest red colors being countries that supply a very large number of commodities to the United States. In other words, we are very dependent upon them. And all of this gets into the concepts of criticality and mineral supply robustness and the ability of us to keep our manufacturing and our way of life going. This was illustrated graphically by a study from the National Academy of Sciences in 2008 with an XY plot showing the impact of a supply restriction on the Y-axis and the supply risk, vulnerability to disruption, on the x-axis. So basically anything to the upper right of this diagram is more critical, is more important, the impact of any sort of supply disruption. Information is also critical. We need to know about the materials that we depend on. And in subsequent talks, people go into more detail about this. The mineral commodities summary that we publish annually is probably the best example of this. The entire world relies upon this information to inform decisions about manufacturing and criticality. Our other main function at the USGS is research. So we do research on the availability of various critical minerals, such as rare earth elements. This is a publication during the crisis with rare earth elements, illustrating that the United States, in fact, has fairly abundant mineral resources that have yet to be developed. Okay, more than 30 different deposits have substantial amounts of earth elements in them. So this is part of the research function that we do, exploring where these deposits occur and how abundant they might be. So I will summarize with several main takeaway points. First, world reserves of almost all the elements that we are discussing as critical or important are adequate, but that production is limited and or dominated by a few sources, such as China, where we get almost all of our rare earth elements from. Thus, the essential question is the possibility of supply disruption, which is possible due to a variety of factors, including natural hazards, earthquakes and tsunamis, such as occurred in Japan, political activity, wars, and other things that could cause some type of disruption. There are several bills currently concerning critical minerals before Congress, and it's unknown how those will work their way through the legislative process. There's also work at the executive level. There are several ongoing studies on critical minerals through the White House Office of Science and Technology Policy, dealing with not only the criteria for identifying criticality, sources of information, the research strategies the nation needs, and we have a lot of cooperation with other international groups, including the European Union, the European Commission, a trilateral commission involving Japan and now Korea, to try to coordinate our various efforts for information and research. In terms of research that's going on right now, the USGS is focused on the genesis and resources of earth element deposits and other critical minerals. We provide information both in terms of mineral commodity summaries and minerals yearbook. And another federal initiative is the DOE Critical Materials Institute that will be discussed further by Rod Eggert. And at that point, I'll conclude and be happy to answer questions later on.